Okay, greetings everybody, welcome to the GLF and welcome to the C4 campus, where I'm going to give you a few ideas and thoughts about what biodiversity is, and start by a sort of a local experiment. You see these logs here, and they were cut a few years ago, and I will show you what biodiversity in action is. And the definition of biodiversity is it's the variability of all organisms from all sources, and it goes from gene to species to ecosystem. But I'm rather using a more simple definition of biodiversity. I mean, biodiversity is the living component of nature. And let's see what it does. If you let them for a few years, you can see that they are colonized by vegetation. I mean, you can see some manioc, some cassava here. And then if you let them a little bit longer, you see that you are slowly, but not so slowly, reconstituting some forest, because the normal ecosystem here is forest. So that's the effect of biodiversity. And biodiversity is what sustains our existence. Without biodiversity, there is no food. There is hardly any medicine, and there is no way that the human can survive. And so we can ask ourselves the question, we human, are we really special? And in a sense, we are, because although we represent a small portion on the biomass on the planet, we have colonized all the ecosystem. In each of the ecosystem that we have colonized, we end up being the top predator. So humans are the super predator, the only unique super predator on Earth. And as a result, we have created our own geological era, the Anthropocene. In a sense, for that, human and special, and we are playing a special role. On the other side, in the grand scheme of things, 99% of the species that ever existed on Earth disappeared, going extinct. So the Earth doesn't need you, I mean. Doesn't need me, doesn't need us, doesn't need humanity. So if we want ourselves to survive and reach the average lifespan of a normal species, which is about 1 million years, and we are now at 750,000, so we still have 250,000 years to survive, or if we want to disappear like a global civilization on the average lifespan of a civilization, which is 300 years, which is about 10, 15 years from now, we have to make some choices. And these choices are us. So we are special because we have reached now a situation that is different to the one where we had the previous civilization collapse, when in fact the Roman or the Mayan, they were powerful civilization, but they were local civilization, and they collapsed because of climate change, because of overuse of resources. Our civilization is the only global civilization, and if this civilization is collapsing, that's the end of human life as we know it. Okay, we are now in the Dramaga forest, and this is an example of what happens if you leave biodiversity doing what it does best, which is creating and organizing and complexifying life. And this place, in fact, it's totally artificial. It's something that has been planted 65 years ago and let like that. It was an experiment by the forestry department at the time. And now we have this complex forest with some of the trees that have been planted, but some new seedlings. So this you will show to any average person and they will tell you that's a wonderful natural forest. It's not. It's something that was created ex nihilo. By humans 65 years ago, and let biodiversity do its job. So the question that we have to ask ourselves now is that, have we failed biodiversity for the sake of development? And the answer, unfortunately, is yes. And in the 60s, with the publication of the book Silent Spring by Rachel Carson, there was a very strong environmental lobby in terms of people were protesting against oil spill, against logging, against chemicals. But in the end, what we end up with, the environmentalist lobby was just creating a group of organization and a group of people that were mainly monitoring the decrease and looking at this is the doomsday scenario, we are going to lose biodiversity, but not doing much, unfortunately, at least on the global scale. I mean, locally people were doing things, but and as a result, we are now in a stage where we have a risk of an impending biodiversity collapse, and as a result, a civilization collapse, because we have created, my friend Stephen Smith will tell you, we have created a forever climate change legacy. And so, as biodiversity is the living part of nature, I mean, a sort of, then there is the non-living part of nature that is also very important, and climate is one. And if you look at the five mass extinction that occurred before, only one has been tentatively provoked by the fall of an asteroid. The four other mass extinction have been triggered by climate change, by a volcano or by so. And we are living now in the sixth mass extinction, and we are also having a very strong climate change event. So we need to decide now if we want to do something about it, or if we want to disappear or live a miserable life in the next 50-100 years, and what we leave for our children. And so there is a role for science in doing this, and scientists really need to look at the way systems work, I mean, how do you bring together social and biophysical science to understand what will happen, what will be the feedback loop, how we can solve the problem, how we can shift from fossil fuel energy into renewable energy. And first of all, above all, we need to find ways to protect the biodiversity we have and to restore the biodiversity we lost, because this will be the basis for survival and adaptation. That's the role of science, but science alone cannot do much. I mean, so there is a role for society also. And society, I mean, the civil society, the policy maker, I mean, we should stop tinkering at the edge. I mean, we should take some drastic decision. And we have seen in the past that society can take hard decision, can make sacrifice, but it's mainly when they see a very, acute crisis. So the enemy is at the gates. When we are dealing with slow variable like biodiversity loss or climate change, we are much less intent to do something, because it happens in the past, it doesn't in the future, it doesn't happen to me. I mean, so we need to change this, and we need to move together and create a movement in terms of taking the hard decision and making the sacrifice that we have to do on an equitable manner to protect the biodiversity, mitigate and adapt to climate change, and ultimately ensure the survival of our civilization or better civilization. And for that, a platform like the Global Landscape Forum is very important, because this is a platform where we bring all components on the society, the scientific, the private, the communities, and the public sector, and we try to create a movement where, in fact, we are going to push for this change, building back better in terms of preserving biodiversity, mitigating and adapting to climate change, and ultimately having a better world. Now the question is, can we do it? I think so. The most important question is that, are we ready to do it, or do we want to do it? I leave it at that. Thank you very much.